Okay, good morning, everyone. I am really grateful to the organizers. I think the concept of this symposium is really powerful. So thank you very much for the opportunity of being here. The title of my talk is about the fabric of life. And many of you may not have heard of the concept. So maybe it becomes clearer if I tell you that by the fabric of life, we simply mean nature. And that should be much clearer because nature has always captured our imagination. But many people, maybe the majority of people, think nature is some wilderness out there in some hidden corner of the world. But the idea of what nature is and the links between nature and us has changed dramatically in the past decades. Until the 70s, we had this idea that nature was a bounty out there to be exploited and conquered by men, and biodiversity was a lamentable but unavoidable collateral damage of the great human development enterprise. Or, for nature lovers, nature was some idyllic Eden that we could only protect by isolating it drastically from ourselves. But today we know that these two ideas are not sustained by the scientific evidence. The scientific evidence today shows that, unfortunately, or fortunately, we don't know, there's nothing we can do about it, nature out there is not an idyllic wilderness, is not an idyllic Eden. As Donald Johansson showed yesterday, we've been trying to manipulate nature since before we became human. But it is in the last few decades that our capacity to do it massively has increased very, very, very dramatically. Carl Folke yesterday showed how much our capacity to reconfigure nature has increased vastly in the past 50 years or so. So basically, nature on Earth has become human nature. And there are very few places in the world that don't have even a small imprint of human actions. Also, the fact that we can be separate from nature is also not sustained by the evidence. Insofar we are biological entities, all aspects of our life are directly or indirectly related with the living fabric of Earth around us. Basically, all aspects of our life are sustained by nature, and all aspects of our life, what we do and what we think, are inextricably interwoven with the fabric of life. So, nature is indeed the wilderness out there, but nature is also the weedy wasteland around your corner. Nature is the apples and the fish in your table. Nature is the microbiome you carry around with you everywhere in your intestine and maybe affected the way you look at life. No matter whether you live in the top floor of the highest building on Earth, you are interwoven with nature. Not only because of the interdependence, but also because you also affect nature. Maybe you are affecting it in remote places. Maybe you are affecting it in ways in which you are not even aware of. And this is not a philosophical position. This is what the latest evidence shows. So one of the reasons I like the fabric metaphor is because it conveys this idea of support, of safety net, of interwoven threads, with one of those threads being us. But this is not the only reason why I like the fabric metaphor. I like it because in any fabric, you can distinguish two major components, the woft, the warp, and the weft. Most of us are attracted to the weft. We like the colors, we like the textures. But those who understand of fabrics, those who actually make a living working with fabrics, know that the most important part of the fabric is not the weft, it's the warp. The warp, which is a set of rough, coarse, uniform, dull threads that keep the fabric in place. If you observe carpet merchants, you'll see that the first thing they do is not looking at the colors, not looking at the details. They want to see whether the warp is good, because they know that however beautiful a fabric could be, if the warp is not good, the whole thing will unravel. And we can think of the fabric of life on Earth as a fabric in which we can take a warp approach or a weft approach. The weft approach is embodied in all the long tradition of field naturalists, fascinated by the intricate ways in which each organism is different from the others, fascinated by the exquisite ways in which each organism is adapted to its local environment. But in parallel to this gorgeous tradition of looking at the weft of the fabric of life, there has been another tradition which looks at the warp, at the very general ways in which all the organisms are similar, at the very small number of principles that are underpinning all this fantastic variety. In ecology, we call the people who look at the weft, at the warp, we call them the lumpers in ecology. And I define myself as a lumper, and I would like to share with you a recent exercise of extreme lumping ecology we carried out. And while describing this to you, I would like to honor two eminent lumpers in ecology who have inspired my career from the very beginning. The first one is Theophrastus. You almost certainly haven't met him. He was the father of botany. He was the teacher, one of the teachers of Alexander the Great. And he's also considered the father of all lumpers. He's been dead for thousands of years, obviously. The other eminent lumper I want to honor today is Phil Grime. Unlike Theophrastus, he is alive and well in his late 80s, still doing field work under very challenging weather conditions and having groundbreaking ideas. But going back to our lumping exercise in ecology, you may have noticed the fantastic diversity of plant form and function on Earth. There are about 400,000 vascular plants known to science. What we wanted to do is to find out whether, underpinning all this variety, there were some general patterns, some general ways of being a plant. And in order to do this, we use a shortcut which is called functional trait ecologies. By functional traits, I mean the phenotypic traits that are measurable at the individual organisms that are considered relevant for an organism's response to the environment and also are relevant for the effect of this organism at the level of ecosystem properties. And we think that functional traits are a really powerful way to look at nature. If you think of a biological community out there, you can describe it in terms of the number of species, statistically. You can describe it taxonomically. You can list the names of the species. But you can also describe it in terms of the functional traits that are there. And that gives a really mechanistic insight, both in the likely responses of those organisms to environmental factors, and also in the likely ways these organisms affect major ecosystem properties, which in turn underpin benefits or detriments to people. That's why we like the approach. The trick, of course, is what functional traits to measure, because you can measure any number of them at very different degrees of detail. Because we are lampers, unrepented lampers, we wanted to go for the very fundamental ways in which plants carry out what Darwin called the struggle for existence. And Darwin described three major components in a plant, in this case, a struggle for existence. The struggle for existence is about growth, it's about survival, and it's about reproduction. So what we were trying to do is to identify traits that plants on Earth have that are absolutely essential for capturing these three functions. And we also needed those traits to be available for a very large number of plants on Earth. So we settled for plant height, the size of seeds or spores, leaf size, the density of the stem, and two key properties of leaves. Leaf mass per area, which basically tells you how much carbon is the leaf investing per unit of service. It means how sturdy the leaf is. And we also look at amount of nitrogen per unit of mass of leaf, which is an indicator of how much the leaf is investing in active photosynthesis and metabolism. So we managed to put together a massive data set with all these traits for more than 10% of all vascular plants on Earth. That was a really big team effort. Now, what we wanted to do with this? We wanted to construct and describe the functional space occupied by all vascular plants living today on the planet. So if we imagine a hyperdimensional volume, a six-dimensional cube, each of the dimensions being one of these traits, we wanted to know the size of this hypercube, and we wanted to know how different species of plants were distributed within the hypervolume. If any combination of these traits is possible for any plant, then we would have all the species more or less homogeneously distributed within the hypercube. On the contrary, if some combination of traits were forbidden or very unlikely, we will have more species concentrated in one particular corner of the cube. That was the vision we had, driving the analytical work. And we went through a series of steps. I'm not going to bother you with these steps. But in the end, this is the result we got. Something like 3/4 of the total variation in multidimensional space is captured in only 2 dimensions. It's captured in this plane, which we call the global spectrum of plant form and function. This plane has 2 major axes. One is this one, goes from very small plants with very small leaves and very small seeds, all the way to very tall plants with large leaves and large seeds. The second axis of variation is an axis of lifestyle, of acquisitiveness, of being acquisitive versus being conservative. So here we have leaves which are really slow growing, but once they are displayed, they live very long time, and they hoard resources. All the way to leaves, which are very acquisitive, they are full of nitrogen, they are displayed quickly, they grow quickly, they die quickly. Together, these only 2 dimensions represent most of the essential variation in design of vascular plants on Earth. One good way to understand this space is imagining the plane like the galactic disk of the Milky Way. If you think of the Milky Way, the galaxy is sort of tilted, like this space is. And although the galaxy, of course, has celestial bodies in more than 2 dimensions, most of the celestial mass is concentrated into a rather flat disk. And this is also the case for the global space of plant form and function. It's a really flat volume. It's basically a pancake. Now, let me show you some examples of iconic plants that are in different areas of this space so you have a better mental picture of what's there. Here we have very tall trees with big leaves and big seeds, typically, for example, the Brazil nuts. This is the area of the gymnosperms, for example, the monkey puzzle here. All this area are highly conservative, stress-tolerant plants. Plants which are stress-tolerant in terms of drought and also in terms of strong nutrient limitations. Here we have completely the opposite plants. These plants grow very fast, preempt resources. The leaves tend to be tender, but often toxic, full of nitrogen. And this is the realm of fast-growing acquisitive aquatics and also weedy plants. And here, I want to call your attention to this one. This is Arabidopsis thaliana. Many of you know that this is the favorite model plant in many studies in genetics and molecular biology. Look where it is. It's in a distant corner of the galaxy. So, in essence, despite plant life on Earth is really baroque when it comes to the details, in terms of the basic design can be encapsulated with only 2 coordinates in this space. We indeed were surprised to see it. We expected something much more blobby, not so constrained. But we were even more surprised when we saw how species are distributed within space. And now if you have a look at the colors, the colors represent a probability density map, meaning that these red hot areas are areas where there are very many species with more or less the same combination of traits. And the paler areas are areas where only very few species, if any, have those particular trait combinations. And you can see here, and I think it's really surprising, that most of our evolutionary heritage, in terms of number species, not in terms of biomass, is concentrated in these two red-hot functional hotspots. These hotspots is mostly trees. These hotspots is mostly forbs. There's nothing surprising about these two plant styles. They are your regular forb when you walk in a country path, and this is the regular tree you used to draw when you were in primary school. They are very, very common plants, almost boring plants, because most of the plants on Earth have these designs. Now, these two hotspots are not an accident of history. It's not like at some point in evolutionary history, speciation went wild and then stopped. Very many phylogenetically distant families and orders of plants converge into these spots, meaning that these are successful combination of traits achieved repeatedly during the whole evolutionary history of the angiosperms. But we found exciting not only the hotspots, also the cold spots. You see, some of these areas are basically empty. Some of them are empty because they are biomechanically unlikely or impossible. You cannot really hang a big seed from a tiny plant. And if you're a tall plant, you need to have some stem density, otherwise you will not stand up. But there are many combinations of traits here that are biomechanically perfectly viable and still extremely rare. So that, and the fact that the distribution of plants is very, very heterogeneous within this space, with really popular areas and really unpopular ones, to us is the hallmark of natural selection. Now, why is this relevant for practical purposes? My impression is that it's very relevant for a number of reasons. Literally 2 days ago, we released a massive international assessment of biodiversity, and one of the main conclusions is that the most important drivers of deterioration in nature in the past 50 years is land use change. And these drivers, mainly land use change, are driving a widespread deterioration of the very fabric of life on Earth, with virtually all indicators of diversity decreasing sharply worldwide. And one interesting here is that the fabric of life is not just becoming smaller, just becoming a smaller version of itself. It's actually changing shape. It's getting big holes in some areas, and it's getting denser in some other areas. Some species are definitely winning the battle, and some species with different traits are losing the battle. And with our approach, we can look at the global spectrum of plant function, form and function, and see, according to the traits, according to the general designs, how are different plants going to be affected by these factors. So if you look at the spectrum, there's one interesting corner, this upper corner, which is a very acquisitive corner. Most of the plants we have as crops, most of the plants we've been using for thousands of years to kill each other and to have fun, are all in that corner. So this corner is being favored over thousands of years by us, directly and indirectly. These plants thrive in all the environments we create, and also we are actively encouraging this corner. We are actually pushing the borders into more acquisitive by natural selection. So plants that are in this corner are in no problem at all with global change, quite to the contrary. On the other hand, there is another corner, which is the corner of plants that have been losing the evolutionary and the ecological battle for quite a while, and now are increasingly in trouble. Superficially, they all look very differently. But when you look at the essential traits describing the spectrum, they are all in the same corner. So if we can think of this spectrum, of this landscape, as the result of both evolutionary history at the long and in the long term, and also our manipulation of life on Earth during our lifetime on Earth. What we are doing now is to actually herd plants from some regions to new regions of the spectrum. We are shifting the hotspots. Earlier in the history of life, there was a hot spot here. Not any longer, not in the last millions of years. And now we are probably herding all these plants toward these hot spots. And we also have theory in place to say, okay, if these are the most popular traits in plant communities on Earth, what are going to be the consequences for major ecosystem processes, and therefore for the different contributions, good contributions and bad contributions we get from ecosystems. And there's good theory, there's good ecosystem ecology theory to link that. We know that the functional traits of the plants which are most abundant in any particular place affect a number of ecosystem processes and therefore affect a number of nature's contributions to people directly underpinned by these ecosystem processes. So, warp ecology, ecology that goes for general common patterns in plants, have a lot to help in managing and being stewards of the fabric of life on Earth. But I said in the beginning that most of us don't care about the warp. We care about the weft. The warp may be essential for the functioning of life on Earth, but it's the beauty of nature which makes us tick. It's the beauty of nature, it's the details who make us the source of joy for us. So we also need to understand the weft. And in understanding the weft, in understanding the details, ecology can help, but it's not enough. Because we cannot possibly model each species on Earth. For example, we, as a follow-up of the results I just showed you, we made this beautiful global model of what are the leaf sizes most likely to occur in different areas of the Earth, depending on the climate. And once we have this surface, then you can say, okay, if the most abundant leaf sizes are X, then this is what we could expect in terms of albedo, in terms of transpiration, in terms of heat exchange with the atmosphere. But this doesn't make people tick. People are not going to take the streets in defense of this model. Because what makes people tick, what makes people feel that they have to fight for the fabric of life, is the fantastic details of the weft. And in understanding how the weft of life is valuable and how we can look after it, ecology is not enough. We need the input from social sciences and humanities, and also, prominently, citizens. And it's together we can get this deeper understanding. Again, we have a good understanding of how, given plants in one place, this is how ecosystem processes are going to look like. But how these ecosystem processes are going to result in different benefits and disbenefits for different people in the world, that is what we still don't understand very well and is crucial. So, in summary, we are not truly ourselves without the fabric of life into which we are interwoven. And this is not a philosophical position. This is what the hard evidence shows. And the fabric of life is unraveling worldwide. It's not just a few holes. It's not just a bunch of global extinctions. It's not just the web. The whole fabric is unraveling. So we need to understand it in order to manage it better. In essence, we can actually describe plant functional diversity on Earth in a very simple terms. We could use, for example, the global spectrum of plant form and function to predict a number of general responses and a number of implications for the global biogeochemical cycles, water, carbon, and biomass. And of course, this warp approach to the fabric of life is indispensable. And probably is all we need if we only care about the effects of life on Earth in terms of primary productivity and biogeochemical cycles. But a weft approach is also indispensable. We do need to team up with other disciplines and other streams of knowledge to capture the many dimensions in which people care about the different aspects of the marvelous fabric of life. And that's all I have to say. I would like to finish with a big thank to all these colleagues that have made my career not only possible, but also deeply enjoyable. Thank you.